Welcome back to Law Sessions Land Law, the second segment of leases and licenses. Now, in the first part, we considered licenses and we looked in some detail as to what a license is. In this part, of course, we will consider further what a lease is. We touched on some terms and definitions briefly at the end of the last segment, but in this session, we will, of course, look at a lease in some more depth. Now, a lease is defined in the Law of Property Act 1925 at section 205(1)(27). It says a lease is an estate in land of defined duration, and it is capable of being a legal estate on the Law of Property Act 1925 section 1, provided it is for a terms of year absolute and as long as it is created in the correct manner which is set out in the Law of Property Act 1925 under sections 52 and 54. Now, the essential characteristics of a terms of year absolute is set out in the leading case of Street and Mountford in 1985. The case developed a three-point definition of a lease, which if it is not met, then the quasi-tenant, as it were, will not have a lease, but rather a license. And the distinction between a lease and a license is that a lease is an estate in land and it therefore binds a third party who comes on subsequently. So the lease is a proprietary right in the land and it is capable of binding a person who buys the land because that person then becomes subject to the lease. A license, on the other hand, is not a right in land, but I would ask you to consider the case of Bruton and London and Quadron Housing Trust in 2000, which has raised some degree of apparent conflict by allowing a certain type of license to be considered such to have proprietary rights. Of course, we will discuss this in a later segment, but for the moment, we will focus on leases. Now, a lease cannot be revoked, meaning it cannot be withdrawn, because it will then breach the contract between the landlord and the tenant. It is a contract, and so it is capable of specific performance. And as such, if the landlord breaches, then of course the tenant has a right. If you have a lease, you may be able to claim statutory protection from the demands of a landlord. Neither a beer license nor a contractual license comes under any form of statutory protection. They are simply permissions to occupy land. So essentially, a lease is a right made in contract to occupy someone else's land for a set period of time. The difference between a lease and a tenancy is that they're essentially, there is no difference. They are the same. However, when you speak about a lease and a tenancy, you look more or less to the duration. So they're essentially the same, which is that they occupy someone else's land. However, the lease is usually used as a term when there's a set period of time which runs for a fixed term of over a year. Example, for 3 years or 99 years or 999 years, you consider that a lease. Tenancy is usually the term reserved for a period of 1 year or less. And both will, of course, give rise to landlord and tenant obligations, some more than others. In approaching a lease question, for example, remember the principles that I raised in the introductory lecture. And if you haven't had a chance to look at it, I would certainly encourage you to go to the introductory lecture because I raised some points which are very important when you are seeking to consider exam questions on land law. And what I raised in the introductory lecture is that you should consider the right. So in this lecture, of course, we are considering leases. So you consider the right, you consider whether the right is legal or equitable, and then you consider how the right is affected in registered or unregistered land. For leases, we will consider the framework logically. And as I go through it, I will start with first, the essence or essentials of a lease, which shows, of course, how the right is created. Then two, the creation itself of a lease. So how legally a lease is created and how in equity a lease is created. And lastly, we'll of course look at how a lease is protected, so its effect in registered land and unregistered land on a subsequent third party. Now, if we consider first of all, the first requirement, which is the essence of a lease. Now, the three essentials is that a lease will exist if there is exclusive possession and there is a certain term, meaning certainty of duration, and rent or consideration is provided. A lease, of course, will not exist, even if you meet those three criteria, if there is no intention to create a legal relationship, or what has been done is no more than an act of friendship or generosity, or there is a service occupancy, or there is a lodger. Now, it means that even if I allow my friend to stay in my spare bedroom and that person has exclusive possession, he pays me a nominal sum of say £10 a month, and I've told him that he can stay there for 6 months, this will not give rise to a lease because the fact that he's a lodger will militate against that. So if we consider the first requirement, which is exclusive possession, well, a tenant as opposed to a licensee will have the right to exclusive possession of the premises demised. An exclusive possession is derived from it the instrument granting the right of occupation, meaning of course the lease agreement. The tenant must be given the right to exclude all other persons from the demised premises, and this of course includes the right to exclude the landlord. The landlord has no right of entry unless he makes provision for this in the lease, such as the right to inspect for repairs. But again, he must even in that circumstances agree it with the tenant as to when he's coming into the property. A good example is the case of Upper and Parncliffe Investments, which is a 1964 case. And in the case, under the agreement, the landlord had reserved the right to enter the property at will on the premises for the purposes of emptying the gas and electricity meter and changing linen at the property. The court said that the tenant did not have exclusive possession as the landlord could come and go as he pleased. That is what it means by he could come at will. Now, if the instrument confers exclusive possession upon the occupier, it means that the occupier has the right, as I said, to exclude everyone, including the landlord. And an occupier who has exclusive possession of premises is likely to be a tenant rather than a licensee. Now, the idea of exclusive possession being one of the main ingredient for a lease goes back to a sort of historical perspective which began in the 1960s. And there we saw English landlord-tenant legislation, which can be very, very tenant-friendly. We saw that the 1960s was a time when landlords attempted to avoid the apparent harsh effects of the rent tax, which gave tenants very substantial security of tenure. They attempted to then avoid the requirements, the landlords that is, sought to avoid the requirements of the rent tax by giving tenants rights of occupancy, which they stated were licenses, though in practice, when you looked at it, they were leases. Well, at first, the courts decided that they would prevent property owners avoiding the effects of the rent tax by simply framing the agreement as a license as opposed to a lease. And the decision in Faccini and Bryson 1952 is a good example of this policy at work. Now, in the case, the court said that a lease had been created despite the fact that the agreement was stated to be a license and actually contained a term that nothing in this agreement shall be construed to create a tenancy. The courts looked beyond the form and looked to the substance, as it were. Now, during the 1970s, there appeared to be a slight shift in the attitude of the courts that started to give primacy to the party's intentions and what was stated, rather to an objective assessment of what had been created. Now, this shift is thought to have been provoked not by a perceived change in the relationship between the parties, but because of the reaction to the effects of the rent tax themselves. Originally, the rent tax were seen as attempting to protect vulnerable tenants, but later on, they were regarded as an increasing burden to landlords that was badly distorting the private rental property market to the extent that there was a shortage of rental accommodation nationally. Now, the changes can be seen in the judgment of Lord Denning, who had previously sat in the case of Fachini and Bryson. And so we see that in Shellmex and BP Limited and Manchester Garages in 1971, he gave primacy to the intention of the parties in order to avoid the effects of the rent tax. And he said, "I realize that this means that the parties can, by agreeing on a license, get out of the rent act. But so be it. It may be not a bad thing." So we see, of course, a shift towards the landlord's considerations. Now, the new approach is best described as a subjective approach that takes into consideration the expressed intentions of the parties rather than the substantive and objective reality of what was actually being created. Now, if we look at a case, Summon Hazler's in 1978, this case shows pretty much where the courts took this. And in the case, an unmarried couple entered into an agreement with the owner of a house for the use of a bedsit. And for those not au fait with English lingo, that is more or less a studio apartment. Now, the agreement was stated to be a license, and the two were required to sign separate agreements. Because if I may pause here, one of the things that makes something a lease rather than a license is where, for example, you have a joint tenancy. So if there are two persons signing one agreement, that tends to go to show that it is a lease rather than a license. Now, in the case, it was a term of the agreement that the licensee may be required to share their accommodation with such licensees or invitees whom the licensor shall from time to time permit to use this room. Now, it was clear that the couple really enjoyed exclusive occupation of the bedsit and therefore exclusive possession, and that the agreement was calculated to avoid the effects of the rent tax. Now, the couple later claimed that they had a lease, but the Court of Appeals said that nothing more than a license had been created. Now, the decision does appear a somewhat strange decision because it is unlikely and it is clearly incredible to suggest that the landlord could impose other occupiers on the couple when the room was only a studio apartment or a bedsit that was somewhere in the order of 20 foot by 18 foot. Equally, if one of the present occupiers left, would it be possible for the landlord to allow or say impose another occupier of a different sex on the party who remained? Well, those are the types of considerations that I want you to take on board, because that was the point, is that it was set out to be a license and therefore the landlord could let anybody come in. But look at the reality of the situation. Now, the reality of the situation was, of course, that the landlord had no intention of doing either of these things, and the arrangement, in fact, was a sham to avoid the provisions of the Rent Act, although the court concluded otherwise. The subjective approach that gave primacy to the expressed intentions of the parties rather than the reality of the situation was finally ended in the seminal case itself of Street and Mountford. Now, in that case, Mrs. Mountford had signed an agreement which was called a license agreement, under which she was granted the right to occupy two rooms for a rent of £37 per week. Now, at the bottom of the document, she had signed where it said, "I understand and accept that a license in the above form does not and is not intended to give me a tenancy protected under the Rent Act." In this case, the House of Lords, whose judgment was delivered by Lord Templeman, considered that an objective stance should be taken in determining what had been created by the parties' agreement. And the key element that Lord Templeman identified was exclusive possession at a rent for a term. If these elements were present, then a tenancy had been created, not a license, irrespective at what the parties had chosen to call it. And Lord Templeman made an interesting statement. He said, the manufacturer of a five-pronged implement for digging results in a fork, even if the manufacturer, who is unfamiliar with the English language, insists that he intended to make and has made a spade. So, it means by that the parties, if the parties describe the agreement as something which it is not, then the courts of course is saying this is not determinative, and therefore, as it looks at it, the court will look at the nature of the transaction. And of course, this approach was subsequently adopted in the case of Antoniadis and Villiers. Now, Antoniadis and Villiers, a 1980 case, was pretty much similar facts to Summer and Hazler's. Now, you remember Summer and Hazler's is the case with the bedsit, the studio apartment. Now, in Antoniadis and Villiers, there were cohabitees who shared a flat, and each had an agreement titled a license, saying that the landlord could use the room at the same time and allow others also to use the room. Now, the court said that, no, that's not the situation here. The court said they had a lease. Court said they were living in one room, sharing one bed, and no one could ever believe for a moment that the landlord would share it as well. Well, we don't know what was happening there, but court is saying the landlord will not share it as well. The agreement, the court said, was a sham. Now, I want you to contrast this, of course, with what happened in Summer and Hazler's, because what we see is Antoniadis and Villiers showing the court's later stance and what they considered an objective approach in all the circumstances. Now, the cases, of course, certainly show that if it is a license, the courts are certainly not going to be backward in coming forward in saying that it is a license. So, in the case of AG Securities and Vaughan, there were four people sharing a four-bedroom flat. They had identical agreements, term licenses. Each was for 6 months without the right of exclusive possession of any part of the flat, and it included provisions for a new person to be replaced if one person left. However, it was stated also that this replacement would, of course, be mutually agreed. Now, that was the actuality of the situation. The court said that they only had a license. There was no joint tenancy, which would have made it a lease, of course, as I mentioned earlier. Each had a separate agreement. Their agreements were between the landlord and the individuals. Now, what if the landlord keeps a key? This is something that examiners like to ask. Well, it doesn't matter if the landlord keeps a key. It is still exclusive possession if it is that the landlord has kept a key to use it in emergencies, and therefore, it doesn't confirm anything that he can come at will. Now, that is different, of course, when you're looking at a hotel, because that is a license. Now, in Aslan and Murphy, Lord Donaldson, master of the rolls as he then was, stated that it didn't matter that the landlord kept a key. He said what really mattered was why he wanted to keep a key and what he used it for. If the grantor remains in general control of the property as well, this is another factor which goes towards it being a license. So in the case of Wells and Kingston upon Hull Corporation, there was a graving dock which was let, but the corporation retained the right to open and shut the gates, they had a key, and to also clean the docks. It was held that only a license and not a lease had been created because the corporation had general control. Now, after the break, what we will consider is once you've met these requirements as set out in the cases for a lease in Street and Mountford, then what we will consider is then, how do you create a lease? After the break, we will discuss that.